morning. And the Lord be with you.
Also with you.
A very warm welcome to everyone as we gather in the Lord's house for worship this morning. Just a few announcements as we begin. First off, do we have a report on stewardship? Do we have a report on how things went last week?
Yes, 32 cars were returned for $174,000.
Okay. Well, thank you all very much for your pledges, and thank you for your work on that. If anyone still has a pledge card they haven't turned in and would like to, you can either give that to Carol Bightley or just place it in the offering envelope, an offering plate, and it will get to where it needs to be. A reminder that we don't have Monday or Wednesday Bible studies this week or next. The next Monday Bible study begins on Monday, December the 5th. It's going to be a broad kind of book study looking at the Old Testament. It's going to be looking at the Messiah and how he's revealed in the Old Testament in various places. So if you'd be interested in taking that, it's Monday afternoons at 1:30. There's a sign up so we know how many books to get. Just sign up and we'll report for you on December the 5th. Advent is just around the corner, believe it or not. That begins on Sunday, November 27th. There are Advent devotionals out in the narthex now if you'd like to take one. They're from Lutheran Hour Ministries. If you'd like to hand some out someplace where you go, just talk to Debbie. She can make some more extra ones for you in the church office. Is there anything else we need to share this morning? Yes.
We're going to have coffee hour next week. So if anybody wants to bring something, that's fine. Otherwise, we'll just be drinking coffee and visiting.
Okay. Yes.
I just want to call your attention to the notice in the bulletin about the mitten tree. They have their website listed in here. We have their website listed in here. And I would encourage you to take a look at that. They have two very good videos that explain their ministry much better than I can. So you might want to take a look at that. The cutoff date is December 11th. And if you have any questions, you can speak to Dr. Gaskell or myself.
All right. That sounds good. Yes.
My friend in Florida, Billy Walton, they called, told me they got the check. They were very appreciative. He said, next time they come back to Richmond, they go, come over here.
But we look forward to meeting him and having him here with us. But it was a blessing to be able to be helpful to him. And thank you for bringing that to our attention that we could do it. Anything else we need to share this morning? There is a council meeting right after church, so council members, please move to the fellowship hall. But today is the last day to be receiving the boxes, the shoe boxes with Samaritan's Purse. So we want to bless these as we get ready to send them away. Let's have a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the wonderful gifts that you enrich us with. And the opportunities that we have to share of those blessings. Lord, you've given us those things that we might use them to care for ourselves and our family, but also especially that we might care for others here in our community, as well as in distant lands. We pray that as these boxes go to various places around the world, that you would use them as an opportunity to be of help to people, especially to be of help in bringing the gospel message that they might hear of Jesus and believe on his name, trusting in the salvation that he brings. We pray this through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Lord bless these boxes to whomever they may go, that the Lord Jesus would work faith in their hearts. Amen. And with that, we stand and sing our opening hymn. draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Heaven and earth will pass away.
The Lord will not pass away.
I lift up my eyes to the hills.
From where does my help come?
My help comes from the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
The Lord is your keeper.
The Lord is your shade on the right hand.
The Lord will keep you from all evil.
He will keep you from all evil.
The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Heaven and earth will pass away. O Lord,
have mercy.
O Christ,
have mercy.
O Lord,
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, almighty and ever-living God, you have given exceedingly great and precious promises to those who trust in you. Rule and govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may live and abide forever in your Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
The Old Testament reading is from Malachi, chapter 4. For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and all evildoers will be stubble. The day that is coming shall set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch. But for you who fear my name, the Sun of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. You shall go out leaping like calves from the stall, and you shall tread down the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day when I act, says the Lord of hosts. Remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and just decrees that I commanded him in Horeb for all Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Finally, brothers, pray for us that the word of the Lord may speed ahead and be honored as happened among you, and that we may be delivered from wicked and evil men. For not all have faith, but the Lord is faithful. He will establish you and guard you against the evil one. And we have confidence in the Lord about you that you are doing and will do the things that we command. May the Lord direct your hearts to the love of God and to the steadfastness of Christ. Now we command you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you keep away from any brother who is walking in idleness and not in accord with the tradition that you received from us. For you yourselves know how you ought to imitate us, because we were not idle when we were with you, nor did we eat anyone's bread without paying for it. But with toil and labor we worked night and day, that we might not be a burden to any of you. It was not because we did not have that right, but to give you in ourselves an example to imitate. For even when we were with you, we would give you this command: if anyone is not willing to work, let him not eat. For we hear that some among you walk in idleness, not busy at work, but busybodies. Now such persons we command and encourage in the Lord Jesus Christ to do their work quietly, and to earn their own living. As for you, brothers, do not grow weary in doing good. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation.
They have washed their robes and made them white as snow.
Blessed are those whose strength is in you.
In whose heart the light is
shining. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 21st chapter. While some were speaking of the temple, how it was adorned with noble stones and offerings, Jesus said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." And they asked him, "Teacher, when will these things be? And what will be the sign when these things are about to take place?" And he said, "See that you are not led astray, for many will come in my name, saying, 'I am he,' and 'The time is at hand.' Do not go after them. And when you hear of wars and tumults, do not be terrified, for these things must first take place, but the end will not be at once." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and pestilences. And there will be terrors and great signs from heaven. But before all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you, delivering you up to the synagogues and prisons. And you will be brought before kings and governors for my name's sake. This will be your opportunity to bear witness. Settle it, therefore, in your minds, not to meditate beforehand how to answer. For I will give you a mouth and wisdom, which none of your adversaries will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be delivered up, even by parents and brothers and relatives and friends. And some of you they will put to death. You will be hated by all for my name's sake, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you will gain your lives. But when you see Jerusalem surrounded by armies, then know that its desolation has come near. Then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let those who are inside the city depart, and let not those who are out in the country enter it. For these are days of vengeance, to fulfill all that is written. Alas, for women who are pregnant and for those who are nursing infants in those days. For there will be great distress upon the earth and wrath against his people. They will fall by the edge of the sword and be led captive among all nations. And Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. And there will be signs in sun and moon and stars, and on the earth distress of nations and perplexity because of the roaring of the sea and the waves, people fainting with fear and with foreboding of what is coming on the world. For the powers of the heavens will be shaken, and then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Christ.
And we join together in confessing our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory. glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. This time I invite you children who are here to come forward for the children's message. Good morning. How are you guys today? I'm doing very well, thank you. Question for you today. Have you ever thought about what you want to be when you grow up? What do you want to do? Oh, Andy gets to go first. Okay. You're going to be a teacher. All right. Very nice. That's a good thing to be. What do you want to be? You want to be a teacher too? Okay. Do you want to teach anything special? Engineering? Okay. And nothing special for Andy. Okay. There's all sorts of things you can teach, but you have time to decide that yet. The reason I ask you what you want to be when you grow up is because our epistle reading kind of talks about that today. It talks about idleness. And idleness means not doing anything. Ever have a day where you just didn't do anything? No. Ever get to sleep in, maybe? Okay. What else do you do sometimes? You get to watch cartoons on Saturday mornings or other times? You watch shows? Do you play video games? What if you could just do that all the time? Then you're lazy. That's right. And that's exactly what our epistle reading is talking about today. There were people in this area. The place was called Thessalonica, but that doesn't really matter. What St. Paul was talking about was there were people who knew Jesus had said there's going to be a day when he's going to come back. So what do you think they did? Nothing. They sat there and they did nothing. They didn't get a job. They were just waiting. So they were busy talking to people and waiting around and all of that. How do you think they got their meals? They just expected someone to feed them. You laugh. Who feeds you? You feed yourself? I think your mom thinks there might be a little more to it than just that. But you're still young, and you're going to school. So your job right now is to go to school, right? You have some chores, probably, that you do at home. Yeah. All of those kind of things. Right now, that's your work. But someday, you're going to have a bigger job. And that's what St. Paul is saying. While we're waiting for Jesus to come back, because he will someday, we're supposed to stay busy. And what we stay busy doing is doing the things that are helpful to others around us. And it also helps take care of us by enabling us to eat. He even says in here, if anyone is not willing to work, let him not eat. So the message to mom and dad, if you don't want to do your chores, no dinner tonight. That's really what he's saying here. We all need to be willing to work, help others. It also blesses us and takes care of us. And that's the good news that he has for us. Stay busy. Think about the things you want to do when you grow up, things that will be helpful for others and for yourself. Teaching, that's a good thing. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you so much for the wonderful blessings that you give. Help us to stay busy in your work, caring for those around us and caring for ourselves and all the days ahead, while we wait for the day when you return to us in power and glory. What a glorious day that will be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, thanks for coming up. Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God the Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for this morning's message is from the gospel reading that we heard a few moments ago. I share with you these words. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, straighten up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we hear the words that are told to us by Jesus today, we have a couple of different things that are getting pushed together. Right now, as we're coming near the end of the church year, we're thinking a lot about Jesus' return in power and glory. But what's happening in our text here is first, they're talking about the destruction of Jerusalem. And that happened back in AD 70. Jesus had come into our world. He had suffered and died and risen again. There was no need for any more sacrifice. It had been done once and for all, and our salvation was secure. But many didn't believe, and many continued on in the Jewish faith, and they continued offering sacrifices as though that was necessary. And Jesus had foretold that there would be a day when that temple would be destroyed, that that would be ended once and for all. Since they wouldn't do it themselves, God would do it. And he did that with Rome coming in and a terrible siege that came upon Jerusalem. And it was a terrible time, and it's foretold in our text today. But that text also then goes on to look more towards the end of time, and it blends it together. When Jesus is going to be returning in power and glory and coming to gather together his elect. But what you have is what at first may sound like a text of doom and gloom. How's the world going to look? Well, let me ask you first, just to think for a second, how does the world look? You might think it looks kind of doom and gloom, at least at times. There's ups and downs, aren't there? A lot of folks had hopes in the elections, and from what I can hear, no one's happy with the outcome of the elections, either the left or the right. No one's completely satisfied that they got what they wanted. Doom and gloom prevails once again. No one's going to have the things they want. Troubles are going to continue to come upon us. But then, as you also think about the world in general around us, how's it going? Forget about elections for a moment. Forget about the powers that be. Just in general, how is the world? It's a mess, pretty much the way I see it. There's good things about the world. God still has his church here. There's places where we can come and gather and hear his word, receive his sacrament, know that we stand forgiven and redeemed in Jesus Christ. But you look at the world and it's filled with supply chain shortages. Thanksgiving is coming. I had not heard that there was a turkey shortage this year, but I walked into the new Arby's just to see what it looked like the other day. And first thing you're greeted with is, due to the national shortage of turkey, they have no turkey sandwiches or whatever other turkey things that they would offer at Arby's. We've been going through this for years now, haven't we? One shortage or another. The world's a mess. Now, that's not doom and gloom being short on turkey, but it's doom and gloom when you look at supply chain shortages, lack of fuels to get through the winter for some folks, potentially, lack of fuel to be able to deliver products to the stores, that there is strife between nations. I mean, these are things that Jesus is telling us about in the text today. Nation will rise against nation. I mentioned this in Bible class, but in my life, we've never been concerned really about nuclear war, because everyone knew that that was just a terrible thing to do. But then today you hear Russia might just do it. Never heard of that in my life. Those who came before me, yes, I think you had practices and things like that, thinking about those things. But the reality of strife in the world, the reality of moral decay in the world, the sense that everything is sort of falling apart is very real. And that's what Jesus is talking about. It's going to happen all around us. And it's going to get worse rather than better. Yeah, we'll have progress as far as technology and a lot of things go. but we're also going to be falling apart as it goes for our faith and theology and morals and things like that. We can expect the world to continue to decay until the day finally comes when Jesus returns in power and glory. But what's he telling us to do in the middle of all this? I mean, why bother telling us about this doom and gloom? Because he says, in the midst of all of it, raise your heads up. When you see these things happening, what's happening is exactly what Jesus said was going to happen. He says, don't worry about it. God is still firmly in control. We talked about this in Bible class also this morning, that Job was a great place to look. What was happening in Job? Job's world fell apart. His family destroyed. His wealth was lost. All sorts of terrible things fell upon him. But yet he kept his hope in God. And God was with him through it all. And in the end, God even blessed him again. Now, God doesn't promise us earthly blessings in the end. But he does promise forgiveness and life eternal through faith in Jesus Christ. And that's why he says, in the midst of a world that is falling apart, we continue to be his hands and feet, his voice here in this world, preaching and proclaiming the gospel of Jesus Christ, announcing forgiveness in his name. He said for his immediate followers, there were even times that they were going to be brought before kings and authorities. If you read through the book of Acts, you see exactly that happening. That the disciples, the apostles, were brought before various authorities. And when they were confronted about their faith, they spoke of Jesus Christ. That they put their hope in him above any earthly authority. That whatever the world might command them to do, if it conflicted with what God had commanded, they followed God. And they accepted whatever punishment might come their way, because they knew that they trusted God and that he should be trusted over and above anyone or anything else. So as you see the world around us, in many ways falling apart, hold your head high. Straighten up. You can be of good cheer because your God is coming. In fact, he has said he's going to be with you all the way through everything. No matter what difficulties you might have to endure, what troubles you might have, he's going to be with you. He's going to be your strength, and he's going to uphold you. And one day when we least expect it, he's going to return. And we're going to see him return just as he had ascended back on Ascension Day. As the disciples were there and they watched him ascend into the heavens on the clouds, he's going to return in the same way. And time, as we know it, is going to come to an end, and he's going to bring his elect, those in faith in Jesus Christ, to be with him in eternity. And what a blessed day that's going to be. A day of wailing for many, and a day of great joy for those who know Jesus as Lord and Savior. So his message through all of this is always be prepared. Be ready. And that means to be repentant of your sin. Because every one of us is a sinner, falling short of being the people that God would have us to be. Have a repentant heart, acknowledging your sin before God, desiring his forgiveness and trusting in him. Come and receive his sacrament as you have opportunity. Take advantage of the gifts that he gives to you. Because those are for you and for the strengthening of your faith. That in the difficult times that will come, the difficult times that might be here already, you're receiving what you need to stand firm and receiving what you need to stay strong in that faith all the days of your life. God says he won't leave us. He won't abandon us. He won't forget about us. But he's going to be with us. He's going to strengthen us. And one day he's going to return to gather us to be with him in eternity. While we await that time, it's going to look pretty bleak around us. And he says, straighten up. Raise your heads. Because your redemption is drawing near. We can be of great joy. Because we know the end of the story. We know what Jesus has done through his suffering, death, and resurrection. We know the salvation that he has earned for us and how sure and certain that is. So we can endure whatever might come, knowing our home is with him and that we are going to be with him forever. In Jesus' name, amen. We rise for prayer. In our prayers this morning, in addition to those who are listed in your worship folder, we want to pray for Pastor Les Stano, who's going to be having some surgery this week, for Eleanor Gilmain, who's having surgery this week, and for Peg Davis, who's also having surgery this week. We also pray for the family of Monty Knuckles, cousin of Sydney Langford. She passed away this last week. Her funeral service is going to be tomorrow. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord. For the Holy Christian Church here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling of all to faith, let us pray to the Lord. For this nation, especially for President Biden and Governor Youngkin, for our cities and communities, and for the common welfare of us all, let us pray to the Lord. For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord. For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, especially for our military and police, for Troy, Brad, Brandon, Andrew, Jeremy, Jordan, Kyle, Garrett, Meredith, Vic Jr., and for Mike, as well as for our healthcare workers, for Hannah, Ashley, Tammy, Sarah, Deborah, Kylan, Brittany, Amy, Samantha, and Tia. And for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord. For all those in need, for the hungry and homeless, for the widowed and orphaned, and for all those in prison, let us pray to the Lord. For the sick and dying, and for all those who care for them, especially for Jean, Peg, Kevin, Frank, for Eleanor, for Eleanor, for Pam, for Pastor Les, for Charles, for Liz, Pat, Betty, Margaret, Tom, Paul, Richard, Don, Faye, Butch, Bill, Patrick, and Stuart. For Faye, Bobby, Pastor John, Bill, Todd, Buddy, and Cindy, Thelma, and Lisa. For Sherry, Catherine, Tommy, Robin, Elsie, Mark, Connie, Michelle, April, and Todd, and Sharon. For Amy, Michelle, Sharon, Carol, Lucille, Paul, Wendy, Billy, Rob, Terry, Peggy, Christy, and Bill. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those who grieve the passing of loved ones, that they would know the comfort that is found in Jesus Christ our Lord, the one who brings us the peace that passes all understanding. Be especially with the family of Monty Knuckles this day, as well as with all of those who grieve the passing of loved ones. Let us pray to the Lord. For our missionaries and those involved in international ministries, that you would be with them, that you would remind them of that presence, giving them a sense of peace as they carry out their work in distant lands, and that you would empower the proclamation of the gospel, that through their work, many would come to know you, and knowing you, believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Be especially with Pastor Matt Wood and family, and Pastor Gustavo Maita and family. Let us pray to the Lord. Finally, for these and for all our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Please rise. Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink of it, all of you. This cup is my blood of the New Testament, which has been poured out for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Do this as oft as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given for you. Take and eat the true body, given for you. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Strengthen and preserve you in one true faith from this life and on into life everlasting. Depart in peace. Serve the Lord. Thank you.
given greeting. Body of blood strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith from this life and on into the life everlasting. Depart in peace. Serve the Lord. Lord's table. Take and eat the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given for you. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Now may this body and blood strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith from this life and on into life everlasting. Depart in peace. Serve the Lord. Please rise. unto the Lord, for he is good. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go in peace.